Last time we ran down a simple Ajax application, and it took input from the user, and it converted from Fahrenheit to, no, from Celsius, converted from one scale to two other scales, Kelvin and Fahrenheit, I think, from Celsius. So today we're gonna revisit that. We're gonna change it up a little bit, and we are going to look at an approach that you can take to troubleshoot it. One thing that's difficult about modern programming, and by modern programming, object-oriented, less procedural than it's been in years ago, is that instead of having one giant thing that's your program, you have a series of components that each do a job, all right? And that's good for a lot of reasons that we talked about, for maintainability purposes, breaking down a big problem into smaller problems, and so on. What's bad, though, is that can make troubleshooting more difficult, because now you have several places where things could go wrong as opposed to one place where things could go wrong. So in our case, it's not even that we have two things, JavaScript and PHP. We have JavaScript, we have PHP, and we have the manner in which they communicate back and forth. So really, with two components, there's sort of three things in general terms that could go wrong. So that makes that a little bit of troubleshooting. The point is that it pays to have a systematic way of troubleshooting, of a way of looking at the problem and making sure everything is correct. All right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to download the example from last time. We'll take a minute to look at it. We'll change it a little bit because I don't like the fact that you have to tab out of the field. All right, so we'll change that so you don't have to tab out of the field. And then we will start looking at how we could troubleshoot it. In other words, how we would make sure and how we would build this incrementally. One of the biggest things that I talk about in nearly all of my classes is that it's best not to have one giant program or to try to complete one giant programming task all at the same time, but rather break it down and do a little bit of it at a time and make sure that it works. Well, how can you do that in this situation? We'll take a look at that. So, let me copy the stuff over. We actually have two examples here. I don't know if we'll get through the one. I don't know if we'll get through the other. Alright, we had it so that you can tab out. We'll change that in a minute. We tab out and it takes that and converts it from Fahrenheit to Kelvin. What are the steps in an Ajax application? Number one is the object for the XML HTTP request is created. That is a pipeline from the client to the server. The data goes in both directions using that object. So that's responsible for handling the communication between the client side and the server side. That gets created differently depending on what kind of browser we are using. So if you notice here, we have a function that creates our object. It creates the object one of two different ways, depending on whether the user is running Internet Explorer or not. So we now have a pipeline between the client and the server. And again, we have to do a little bit of tweaking because the manner in which you create that pipeline is different with Internet Explorer as it is with different browsers than it is for different browsers. So now we have a global variable called HTTP. It's global because it's outside of the script tag. I'm sorry, not outside of the script tag, outside of a function. So that's the first step, is creating that request object. The second step is the user action triggers something happening, and in this case, we have an onChange method, which means that the value within the text box has changed, and we have left that field, so we've tabbed out of it. That invokes this, which formats a request and makes a request. Part of the request is to give the function a callback function. A callback function and callback functions in general are used when there's some sort of asynchronous process. That is, when the server's going to do something, the client isn't going to wait for the server to do it. The client is going to continue to do what the client does until it gets a response from the server. Well, that function is going to get called when the server makes a response. And when the server makes a response, this handle response method kicks in because that was our callback function. We make sure the ready state is 4. The ready state being 4 indicates that the server is completed with the request. There's 1, 2, 3, and 4. And again, you can look them up in the book, but it's like the request was made, you know, the server's thinking about it, and so on. The final answer, though, is 4, is where the client has the message back from the server. All right? And in which case, we can take the response and format it and display it on the page. So the steps are, make the pipeline. Make that XML HTTP request object. Format and make the request to the server based on some user action. This is from the client side perspective. The last step then is, when the server is finished, take the response and format it. The server has a real easy job here. The server just has to do its thing. And in fact, it's a simpler job than before because the server doesn't have to worry about formatting and outputting an entire HTML page. It simply outputs the piece of data. And in this case, it outputs comma delimited data. So we have our first field, which is the value in centigrade, and we have our second field, which is a value in Kelvin. All right, first thing I'm going to do, just for fun, I'll leave you to judge if it's actually fun or not, is I'm going to change it so we get a calculation on key down. Here's the interesting thing, and I won't bore you by showing you this, but if you do, I'm sorry, not on key down, on key up. If you do on key down, that key has not been entered yet into the text box, so you'll always be one character behind. So if I did on key down, and I typed in 12, my script would get called with a 1. All right. If I did 123, it would get called with a 12. So, do on key up. because the on key up is when the value is actually in the text box. So I'm going to go here, and I'm going to change this from an on change event to an on key up event. Let's save it, and then I'm going to move it. Now if we go and do this, notice as soon as I start typing in, the conversion occurs. All right. Now you'd have to decide if that is good for what you're doing. And what I guess the criteria would be is if the server can respond quickly enough to it, then it's good. Keep in mind, it's processing now every key request instead of processing when I have changed the field and when I've left the field or when I've pressed a button or something like that. I guess if the operation is an extensive operation and one that would take a lot of time, then you might not want to do it on key up. But in this case, notice that the calculation can happen pretty quickly, so that's okay. So we're kind of doing what Google does here. Whereas, as we type stuff in with every key, we see, oh, this is not, it's a CIE. No, this is Chrome. Yeah, but as we type in, it shows us a list of values and so on. List of possible search terms. All right, so we made that change. Now, remember we said there's four operations. There is the server, or I'm sorry, the client creating the pipeline between it and the server. There is formatting a request. There's the server doing its thing. And then finally, there is the client formatting the output. I'm going to test the server part first. So I'm not going to go 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm going to do 2, 1, 3, 4. All right. I'm going to make sure the server part is correct. Now, in software development, there is what's called unit testing, and then there's what's called system testing. Unit testing is where you test to make sure one piece of the solution is correct. System testing is where you test to make sure the entire solution is correct. It would be like if you were checking a car, right? You might go and hook the battery up to a sensor to see, does the battery have any juice? That will test that one component. That will say, yeah, the battery's working. The battery has power. That's different than saying the battery, when you plug it into the car, will work, right? Because there could be a problem with the cable. There could be a problem with the starter, or there could be a problem with something else. So you can test components individually, and then you test everything together to make sure it works together. So the first thing I want to do is I want to test just the server part. All right? And the thing to keep in mind is with the server part, I should know what the input to the server is, and I should know what the output to the server is supposed to be. What should the input to the server be in this case? In the case of doing the Fahrenheit or Celsius to Fahrenheit and Kelvin conversion, what is the input?
Celsius.
The temperature in Celsius. All right. How am I going to pass that to the second page, to the script that does the processing? Well, there's no action here, right? Because we don't have a form that we're submitting.
I was going to say, like, for a variable?
Yeah, we're going to have a variable, and where are we going to put that variable?
In the script.
We will put it in the script, but how are we going to pass it from the client to the server? We're going to use the pipeline, and we're going to pass the variable on the query string. All right? So if we look here, My script is called convert.php, right? So my request should look something like this. Convert.php, right? Because that's the name of my script. We're going to pass the data on the query string. Now, we're writing both the client and the server script, so we have to coordinate between what our right hand and left hand's doing, right? So I'm going to keep it simple. I'm going to call the temperature temp, all right? Now, that's important because I'm going to have to make sure that the client and server call it the same thing. So I'm going to say temp equals, and then I'm going to have the value in centigrade. So maybe temp equals 0. So that's what the request is going to look like, all right? It's important to know that and to figure that out in advance, right? Because you're going to have to write the code that makes that request. And you're going to have to write the code that processes that request. So you better have a good idea what you want your request to look like. All right? And in this case, we want it to be convert.php question mark temp equals something. Now, what do we want our response to look like? We want our response to look like what? We want it to be the Fahrenheit value, a comma, and I don't remember the value here, 273 maybe. I don't know. Whatever the value is in Kelvin. I think 273 is right. So that's what we want our response to look like. So we need to keep this in the back of our head, right? Because as we're troubleshooting this, we're going to have to make sure that we make the request to look like this, and we're going to have to make sure that the response comes back looking like this. Okay? Because if it doesn't come back like that, then something's wrong, and things aren't going to work. So how can I test to make sure that my server-side code can handle a request that looks like this? I'm going to do this. I'm going to copy that, and I'm going to go, and I'm going to run the server-side script by itself. How do I run it by itself? I just put it up in the address bar. Localhost slash convert.php question mark temp equals 0. So this is the equivalent of pulling a battery out of the car and putting it on a sensor, a meter, to read does it have any juice. Because I'm not touching the client side. I'm just looking at the server side. And if I give this to the server, I should get the response that I'm expecting. 32, 273, separated by a comma. All right? So the trick here is this XML HTTP request I can make as a plain old HTTP request, and the result will get echoed back to the screen. So if I run this test, sure enough, I get 32 and 273. What could go wrong? Well, let's say that I didn't realize that query string variable is called temp. Let's say I thought it was T. Alright? Boy, did I pick a bad value when I picked 0. Let's change it to 100. This should be then 212,373. There we go. 212,373. When I put in temp in. Now look what happens if I put T in. I get the wrong answer. Alright? Why do I get the wrong answer? Well, it's expecting the variable in T and in temp rather, and I'm giving it to it in T. So it, the math goes screwy, and it acts as though the value is zero. Alright? So, I can test the server side by simply typing in the URL in the address bar, making a plain old HTTP request, and looking at the output to make sure it's correct. So, if I look at this, that's what the request ought to look like. That's what's giving me the correct result. All right? So, in our 1, 2, 3, 4, we've looked at step 2. We've looked at if we give the server what it's expecting, it's going to give the right result. One reason I do it in this sequence is now we're kind of done with the server, right? Because that's the server's only job in this transaction. Now what do we have to make sure? We have to make sure that the client makes a request the way that we're expecting it to. We have to make sure that the client gets the response that we're expecting, that we haven't messed that up somehow. And we have to make sure then that the client formats the output. So how am I going to check to make sure? How am I going to check to make sure that the request is made properly? How can we peek into a program and see the inner workings of it? Well, in different languages, you have different options. In JavaScript, one thing that you can always do is do an alert. All right? And what should the alert show? The alert should show what request the client is going to be making of the server, the URL of the request. Well, what's the URL of the request? This part right here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put alert in my code. To display that. Now I'm going to get rid of that eventually, right? This is just debug code. I'm not going to keep it in there because we don't want to show the user this. That would just be confusing for them. So I'm going to put an alert that shows exactly what I'm calling on the server. This matches that exactly. So if I got it right, then I should see what the server's expecting. And what's the server expecting? Something that looks like that. Alright? So, I save this. I'm going to move it. Over here. And I'm going to go and I'm going to type in that URL. And I'm going to press the key and I'm going to see in the alert box what the client is sending to the server. So I type in 1. And sure enough, that looks like the right value for the request. Convert.php question mark temp equals 1. All right, I typed in a 1, temp equals 1. So that's correct. 0, temp equals 10, 100, temp equals 100. So I can put an alert to see exactly what is getting passed and what is getting called on the server. So, if I somehow got this wrong, I got the name of the URL wrong, let's say, for instance, got the name of the URL wrong, and I start typing, I see right up there it's calling convertx.php. Oh, it's not supposed to call convertx.php. No wonder. Yeah, Arial. That's weird. What do you think it's doing? Pardon me? Well, that's the font, yeah. Let's look at what it's probably doing is, that's a good question. I don't know what it's doing. It's not doing it right, though. All right, so we know that. My guess is that this is some sort of error message that came back from the server. And you know what? I don't have to guess. I could actually type in that URL. convertx.php equals 100. And if I were to look at this code, somewhere in here is the font of Arial. So this is the error message that got sent back to the client, because there is no such page called convertx. And the client, being a good sport, tries to format that and display it as the output. It ends up just saying Arial. All right. At any rate, it's clear that something's wrong here. All right. And if we look closely at what's wrong, the server-side script is called convert.php, not convertx. The same thing would apply if I had the wrong query string name. Or if I forgot the comma, even, you know, I would see exactly what's getting called. So to troubleshoot, to make sure that the client is calling the right script, take an alert and display exactly what script you're calling. And in that way, you can make sure. And remember, because we did step one of checking the server side first, we ought to know what the server's expecting. We ought to know the name of the script that we expect to run on the server, and we ought to know the name of the query string variable. So we should know this. We should not be guessing at what this is. We also wrote the server side script. All right? Now, I'm going to make another mistake. Let's say I got that wrong. What symptom would that cause? It'd break the pipeline, right? I've defined that this is who's going to handle any responses from the server, and there is no function. So let's see what happens when we do that. Let me copy this. All right, I type in 1. I don't get anything. Why not? Well, I gave a wrong, that'd be like me giving David a voicemail, but giving the wrong phone number to call me back at. All right? He's trying to respond, but my script is set up, and I said this method's going to get called when the response is gotten instead of that method. Now, how could I tell this? I mean, I know what I did, so I know what I did wrong, but how could I tell this if I didn't intentionally make this mistake? Well, one thing that you could always do is look at your JavaScript console. All right? And that tells me, in pretty clear terms, that handle response, handle response, is not defined. All right? So don't forget to use the tools that are built into the browser. So look to see what the JavaScript error that you get is. So if something doesn't write in Ajax, one of the first things that you should do is look at the JavaScript errors. There's another way to do it. to test this. And that would be to put an alert here to show me that ready state. That ready state should go 1, 2, 3, 4. All right. If we don't see that ready state getting displayed, then this function isn't getting called. So, I go and try to run this in the browser. I type 1, I don't see any of my alerts. So therefore I know that chunk of code isn't getting called. Either way, it should lead you to the fact that I gave the wrong callback function name. So I broke the pipeline. So I'm going to go here and fix it. Now as I type in, what should I see? How many alerts should show up? Go close. We'll see 4 alerts. We'll see it'll equally 1, 2, 3, and 4. Because that's all the steps that it goes through in its way to getting the final answer. So I type in 1, I see, oh, I spoke too soon. I guess it didn't show number 1. 3, 4, so we did see 3. I stand corrected. Not sure why we didn't see 1, but that's a good question. I think 1 is the initial state, so we only see it when the state changes, so 2, 3, 4, very good. All right. So now we know that that function is getting called back. Let me make another mistake here. Let's say I put a semicolon there. There you go. Now, if I run this, I'm going to see what I'm going to do. I forgot to do this. So I'm not going to alert the ready state because I know that piece already works. I am going to alert the response text. What does the response text represent? Right. The answer from the server. All right. The answer in the pipeline from the server to the client. So the server has sent this back using that variable. The client's now going to do something with that variable. So if I go and type that in, oops, I forgot to copy it over. Or did I? Confused. Page at localhost says nothing. All right. Page at localhost shows 33, 274. CISS232. Notice what it did. Because I used the wrong delimiter between those two fields in my JavaScript, because I'm looking for a semicolon, it was not able to split the response into the two pieces. So therefore, it put the entire response into that. It put, didn't know what to put into that. So we displayed that. Actually, I should have moved. This is what I intended to do, because I don't care about that result or response text until I'm all done. So I'm going to put it in as part of the if statement. So I'm only going to see the results when the server has returned the results. That's probably a slightly better way to do it. That way I won't be confused by seeing the results three times. One of the times it being empty because it hasn't, server hasn't responded yet. So there. That's the response we're getting back from our server. If we look at our code, we notice that we are using a semicolon and not a comma, and yet there's a comma between them. So that is why it puts the whole response in degrees Fahrenheit and puts an undefined value in Kelvin. So we change it back to that. And we're debugged. And at this point, we can get rid of any alerts in there. The point of this is that there's sort of two options in debugging your code. One of them is to have sort of a plan and doing it systematically. Like in that case, I used alerts. I checked every step of the process in turn. I checked the server first. Then I checked to see that the request is being made correctly. Then I checked to see if the callback function was getting called. Finally, I checked to see what the server was returning. All right? There's other ways you could do it, for sure. But I'll tell you what, any way that's systematic in trying to troubleshoot like that is better than Plan B. Plan B is simply staring at the code until the answer jumps out at you, all right? Which programmers do too often, you know? And it's one of those things that, like, you know, sometimes you have a revelation, or sometimes if you step away from it, you'll see something that you missed before. But generally speaking, if you're having trouble spotting an error, you can, in some instances, you can stare at it as long as you want, and you'll never end up spotting what the error is, or it will be a long time before you do that. So having sort of a plan and checking step by step is sort of critical in sort of getting the answer to the question of, like, why doesn't this work? So to summarize, I ran the server-side script by itself to make sure it gave me the answer that I wanted. I put an alert in to test to make sure that the client side was making the request I expected it to. I put an alert in to make sure the callback function was getting called. I then put an alert in to see the value of response.txt to make sure that matched what I expected it to do. In order for this to work, you have to know what each side is expecting. All right? And you should know that because it's under your control. You should know, for example, that the server is expecting this script, convert.php, and on the query string, the value for temp. You should know that because you wrote the PHP script. All right? So be sure that that's clear in your mind how you created that script and what it's expecting. You should know that the client is expecting comma delimited data, not tab delimited or semicolon delimited or anything like that. And therefore, you can look at and make sure that what's coming back from the server is in the format that you expected it in. Any questions at this point? Let's look at our other example. All right, we have a quiz. Math quiz. Ooh. 1 + 5 equals. Correct.
Yes.
Yeah. Wrong. Okay. Kind of all or nothing on this one, huh?
100% or zero.
Yep. Now, we're going to spend some time looking at this because I'm just really simplistically putting right or wrong. Alright? I could do a lot more than that. I could make wrong be in giant red letters. I could make right in giant or correct in giant green letters, for example. So we could format the output many different ways. Let's take a look at this. The other thing we could do is we got more than one question on here. Alright? So let's take a look at the code for this. And we will probably only have time to preview the code today. And on Wednesday, we'll come back and we'll do more with this example. As always, I'm going to look at the server-side script first. Why? Because that's simple. That is simpler. All right. I sort of put the hooks in here to handle multiple question quizzes. Which means that I could put the hooks in here to create a random addition problem. So we'll look at some of those things next time. The point is that in this case, I'll tell you what, I forgot that I've had those hooks in for multiple questions, so I don't want to talk about this right now. Alright? We only have 4 minutes left. I don't think I could do it justice. But I will post this example. So take a look at it prior to class on Wednesday. And Wednesday when we come in, we'll look at this and we'll enhance this. And we'll see some of the things that we can do, all right, with this, how we can make this very flexible. So with just a little bit of playing around, we can make this PHP quiz actually be kind of good. All right, questions? Yeah, that's identical.
And then the create request object, that's going to be the same too.
It's going to be mostly the same. Keep in mind that depending on what you're doing, you may, for example, be passing two parameters.
Okay.
Like, for example, if you're doing a tuition calculation, you would need to pass the number of credit hours and the residency status. So the name of the script is going to be different. and what you're passing is going to be different. But in general, it is going to look like this. Actually, let me bring up the other one. Oh, I already had it open. In general, it's going to look something like this.
Okay, so yeah, so you always write the function then where you're going to pass the parameters to do the...
Right.
Okay.
And that always gets triggered by some user event.
But the one above right that where it returns the RO, that's pretty much going to be...
That will be identical until a new browser comes that messes this up. All right. And it's possible even that one has already come around and I just haven't detected it yet.
And then that last part is pretty much that's where you're going to spit out whatever your answer is from the
Exactly. Exactly. That's where you're going to take the answer and format it. So creating the pipeline is identical.
Okay.
Making the request isn't identical, but it's going to look a lot like this because you're going to create, you're going to point to a URL. You're going to pass some values on the query string. You're going to define the callback function. Then you're going to make the request. Handle response is going to be similar in that you're going to look for a ready state of 4 that indicates that you're done. Much of the time, you're going to look at the response text, all right, and then do something with it. Here, I'm splitting it into an array and outputting it in two different sections. Now, for more complicated examples, the response comes back not as plain old text, but as as XML. And therefore, there's more work to take that XML data. So some of the time, you're going to be looking at response text. Some of the time, you're going to look at response XML. All right? Okay. As I indicated, I'm not going to stay for lab. I have a doctor's appointment. So if you have any questions, ask them now.
I just have a curiosity about where you have the comma in the response text. Obviously, you have one comma because you're splitting two.
Right.
If we were returning 3, would you then have comma, comma?
No. Let's take a look at what that code does.
It just looks for a comma and splits it where it sees
exactly.
Comma.
Wherever it sees a comma, it's going to split it. So the difference would be, all right, I'm splitting this text using a comma, and I'm creating an array. You could split it using the letter A, provided you knew the A wasn't going to be...
So split it with anything.
Yeah, you could, provided whatever you were putting in the server script, you looked for in the client script. Usually comma or tab delimited is common, because those things typically don't appear. Like, if you're doing numbers, you're not going to have a comma in the middle of it. All right? Now, the thing is if I had 1, 5, 8, I would still, the split would look the same. The difference being that result array, instead of having 2 elements, would have 3 elements. So I could look at result sub 0, result sub 1, and result sub 2. So in this case, because I know I only have 2 elements, I know I have result 0 and result 1. All right.